In the explicit unconnected primer video, we saw that Ethernet IP is really just a bunch of lookup tables that the device vendor fills out. The blank table template in each class is called an object, and a filled-in table is one specific instance of that object. There was also a table of services, things you can do with these tables, like get and set the values, and another table that listed the attributes of the whole group, things like how many total instances are in this group. All these things taken together are what we call the class. Once you have that picture in your mind, getting or setting a parameter of an Ethernet IP device is easy. Let's do a few examples with an Allen Bradley PowerFlex 40 as the server and a Do-more PLC as the client. In a Do-more Designer software, that flex drive is just another device, so as always, we start with the system configuration and work our way down this list. There's nothing to do at the CPU level, it doesn't affect the I/O of the PLC, and it's not a new module. But it is a new device, so we'll start here. Could we use this one generic Ethernet IP built-in device to talk to all of our Ethernet IP hardware? Sure, but it's much better to create a new Do-more device for each piece of Ethernet IP hardware because each one needs its own TCP/IP connection. If you run all of those connections through one generic Ethernet IP device, it has to manage all of those, which slows things down. If each piece of Ethernet IP hardware has its own device, then things get real simple and much faster. So we'll create a new Ethernet IP device specifically for this flex drive. New device, Ethernet IP client, okay. We'll give it a name, how about flex drive, and the rest of this looks fine. That's it. We just created a device we can talk to. There is no associated I/O mapping and no new structure because there is nothing for us to interact with this Ethernet IP client. Notice that there is a structure for the Ethernet IP server. Some people call that a slave. We'll see that in action in the video where we use the Do-more as a server to another device. For this video, the Do-more is a client or a master device. Great. We've created our Ethernet IP device. Let's talk to it. In this setup, we have a Do-more at this IP address, a Stride Ethernet switch here, and the Allen Bradley PowerFlex 40 drive here on the same subnet at this IP address. To talk to it, we just drag the Ethernet IP instruction from the toolbox in the protocol section and fill in the blanks. We want to talk to our PowerFlex device. Remember, that device, which is a lot like the drivers you have on your Windows PC, manages the hardware for you. It takes care of all the handshaking, the error checking, the memory allocation, etc., so you don't have to mess with any of that. It makes your life easy. We'll enter the device's IP address here, and we have a direct connection, so the default port number is fine. For the rest of this, we just look up the answers in the PowerFlex 40's Ethernet IP adapter manual. In Appendix C, we see all the different classes available. We want the parameter class, so we'll scroll down to page C9. Here's everything we need to know about how the parameter information is organized. The class number is 15. That goes here. This chart is telling me that the drive parameters are the instance numbers. That means these instance tables that we need have the same numbers as the drive's parameters. Well, that's really convenient. In this example, we want the nameplate voltage, which is drive parameter 31, so that's also table or instance 31. It's also telling us that instance 0 is the class attribute table. And here's the format of that table. So if we wanted to know how many parameters are in this class, we would just specify instance 0, attribute 2. Here's the object template, the table format for these instances. The parameter value, the name, the units, the data type, the min value, the max value, everything we could want to know about each drive parameter. We want the value of the nameplate voltage for this first example. Well, that's attribute number 1, so that number 1 goes here. This is the format for the services table for this class. We want to get a single attribute, which is a 0e hex or 14 decimal, so we put that one here. And that's all there is to it. You just go to the hardware manual, look up the numbers for the service, the class, the instance, and the attribute of that instance that you want, and you're done. In this example, we want to get from the parameter class parameter 31, which is instance 31, and we want to know the nameplate voltage of that instance, which is attribute number 1. We'll enable this on an edge, set these bits on success and error, and put the response here, which I happen to know is a 16-bit unsigned result. I'll show you how I know that in just a minute, which is 2 bytes max. Let's add a control bit so we can enable this instruction and transfer the project. Let's bring up a data view and monitor the result, which we put in D1, and the result length, which you put in D2. Let's also add the control bit so we can activate the instruction. When I toggle that control bit, I see the request was successful and the nameplate voltage is 225 volts, and that 2 bytes were returned. Perfect. Well, that's all there is to it. Given these tables, we just look up what we want and fill in the blanks. Ethernet IP is easy once you understand how to navigate these tables. Now, how did I know that that nameplate voltage was an unsigned 16-bit integer? Well, I asked for it. You can see back in Appendix C that the data type is attribute number 5. Let's try that. And since it's almost the exact same thing as we just did, let's just copy that instruction and modify it. The only thing we need to change is the attribute we want. Instead of the parameter value, we want the data type, which is number 5. And let's put that result in D3 and the length in D4. And let's use these for our success bits. We see in Appendix C, attribute number 5 is an unsigned integer, or 8 bits, so we only need 1 byte for that. Click OK. Let's trigger this instruction on the success of the previous one, and write it out to the Do-more. And over in the data view, let's add our new results. Toggle the control bit, and sure enough, the device tells us the data type for parameter 31 is 199, which is C7 hex, which according to our lookup table, is unsigned 16-bit. So before I started this video, I executed this command so I would know what data type to use for that first example we did. Again, everything you need to know is in these tables, and once you understand how to use them, you'll be in total control of your device. Let's do another one. Let's get the name of this parameter. Again, it's almost identical to what we just did, so we'll just copy this instruction. Same class or group of tables, same instance or table number. The only difference is now we want a different row of the table or attribute of the parameter. We see back in Appendix C that the name of the parameter is attribute number 7 and that it's a short string. So we put 7 here and put the result in a string structure. Change the success bits and we're done. Trigger this one on the success of the previous one, accept everything, and write it out to the Do-more. Add our new string to the data view, toggle the control bit, and we see that the name of this parameter is motor nameplate voltage. Awesome. Now, did you notice this little dot right here? That's because the string sent to us from the flex drive has a leading length byte. If I switch this to hex display, this 10 hex, which is 16 decimal, is a count of the characters in the string. And if we do a short string 0.length, it agrees. There are a total of 17 characters, which includes the length byte, in this string. Perfect. Okay, this time we're going to ask the flex drive what the units of the nameplate voltage are. Well, that's exactly what we just did. So we'll copy that instruction and change the attribute we want to the units attribute, attribute number 8. Change the status bits and put the result in short string 1. Great. And let's enable this instruction on the successful completion of the one above it. Accept the changes, write the project to the Do-more. And I'll add the unit string to our data view. Toggle the initial nameplate voltage control bit, and sure enough, we see that the units are volts. What if we wanted to do all of this for the acceleration parameter? Same thing, right? Except now, we want parameter, or instance, number 39. What if you wanted to set a parameter instead of get one? Well, the set service code is 10 hex, or 16 decimal. Everything else, pretty much the same. As you can see, once you get the hang of using these groups of tables, or classes, it's easy to get or set anything you want using just one explicit message instruction. And keep in mind, we only messed with the parameter class of this device. There's a bunch of others you can explore simply by changing the class number here. The only hard part of all this is finding the documents that have the Ethernet IP class information, you know, all those filled out tables, for your target device. Once you've done that, the rest is easy. If you have any questions, please contact Automation Direct's free, award-winning tech support during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help you with any Automation Direct parts. Now, the PowerFlex drive isn't an Automation Direct part, so please don't call and ask about that. But you can ask the folks on the forums. They love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any questions directed at Automation Direct support staff there. They don't monitor the forums on a regular basis. Spend less, do more with Automation Direct.